While I, these are my views, and I'm sure many out here in the media community may not agree with them. Now, while we need to underscore the importance of media in being popular as back as 17th century, the main fourth pillar started to emerge as being one of the most important pillars in evolving democracies. If you look at the role of media in India and the rest of the world, the reality is that we catch up here. We follow the trend. And our media in today is in an evolving state. It's evolving, it's ever changing, it's dynamic. Earlier on, we used to have one channel, now we have multiple channels, multiple interpretations, multiple perspectives. And the most important thing is the role of media in places where there is conflict and places where there is not a conflict. Because in a conflict zone, a mere report, a news report, could mean a dead body, could actually translate into dead body zones. While as when you report in places where there is not a conflict, it could be different ideologies, different perspectives, but not necessarily end up in dead body. The first thing that I would say, with all the humility at my command, is that once we enter the field of journalism, or anybody does, in no sees a human being like us politicians or a businessman, and infallible to perspectives, biases, and like any normative, typical human being. So what does the journalist represent in a conflict? Does he represent a side in the conflict, or does he represent truth? And is truth, is there a monolithic concept of truth? If there is one truth, or are there multiple truths, depending on what you believe? And what does a journalist reporting mean? This is a big question, which I think is staring at the faces of journalistic fraternity, especially in our country. That do they represent the country, or do they represent the truth? Do they represent the reality? And what is the reality? Are they creating a perception, or are they reporting reality? I have stayed in conflict in J&K both as a non-politician and as a politician. I don't know how to put it in words. And I've been in government also for 3 years. I've been a cabinet minister. And I've seen one of the worst strikes relative to 2016. Many times we did not know whether we are fighting the people on the streets or we're fighting the media in the evening. It was so difficult. Wherein the situation was created, we're a small state, we send 6 MPs to the parliament, which is a very small state, nestled somewhere in the north. But the work Kashmir in terms of news sells, there's a lot of PR. And the evening is all debates. And people who, even I, being a politician, being in public life, wouldn't know, I would see them in the evening on all the TV channels and speaking nonsense against the country. And the rest of the country was taking these rooms as representative rooms of Kashmir people. So they were actually pitting the rest of the country against Kashmir people. So we lost it completely. We didn't know who are we fighting. Are we fighting the people who are planting stones on the streets, or are we fighting the media? We had no idea until day we arrived that what happened. So when you report in conflict, there's a thin dividing line, and if you cross it, you become a party to the conflict. I think in our country, we might have erroneously cross that line and become a party to the whole country. There might be TRPs, but in all humility, guys, they are bloody TRPs. They are bloody. There's a lot of blood in those TRPs. And call that Lakshman Rekha or self-censorship. Because on one hand, we want free speech, on one hand, we don't want censorship. And on the other hand, we actually end up becoming a part. And there's so many things. When you talk of patriotism, when you say today, terrorists are here, they fire, brutal damage, fine, we all feel that. We all feel very, very sad. But then, when you now become the spokesperson of the country, when you represent India as an Indian, no, even the concept of Indianness is not static. Take Britishness. 100 years back, the stereotype image for British was somebody white with a tie. Today, Britishness is an Asian also. There's a Pakistani, there's an Indian, there's an African, they're all British. Similarly, the Indianness, what it meant in 47, is not what it means in 2019. And it's not the same what it was in the 80s. Now, even if you look at media report, if you take our conflict in the UK, the shift into violence happened somewhere in the 90s. Prior to that, 87 happened. 87 is one of the notoriously rigged elections. Somewhere, in the name of national interest, the media actually allowed authorities to walk away with murder. It was reported that there have been regained, there has been regained, or there have been malpractices. But the reality is that it is what you see today in 2019. You just cannot delete it from 1987. The same media which allowed authorities to walk away with murder are now setting the last sticks of Indianness for every Kashmiri or every other country, JNK or others. So, even if we look at evolution, even look at 80s. So in 87, something happens in Kashmir in the name of natural interest, the truth is in. Why is that? That time there was a very responsible media, I remember when I was a school going student. We've grown, we've seen communal rights. I remember there was a bureau, and it was Indian Express, a kind of India, from Kashmir. We used to get the newspaper at 4 p.m. They would come by air. But they would never mention the communities. They would say people of a particular community attack the people of another community. So there was some responsibility shown when it came to riots across the country. But when it came to J&K state, again there was this national interest thing, and they played down what should have been played up. And we have ended up with it. Now even today, while our heart goes up, I have seen a death in my own family, a violent death. So I can very well understand. I think more than the other lucky ones who have not seen death in family, which is violent, I have received the dead body of my father. So I know the pain that these 40 brave martyrs, what their families must be going through at this moment, what happened to one. I honestly don't want to do it. I don't want anything to do until somebody sends a clip on the phone and it's sort of that. But I was in the TV lounge and I was coming today with this program, and I happened to watch one. Well, there was a TV, there, and there was a news program. And I was surprised they already declared war. They had declared war. And it's the reality that even Pakistan has, I think, is on another in terms of air defenses. This is totally a new thing. They are also taking the media seriously. And they are also on a high alert. The media is actually trespassed into a territory that simply does not belong to it. And conflict reporting. I remember KPD in Libya when it was formed in the 80s. The traditional BBC line, I think, at that time was not to focus too much on collateral damage, only to focus on the damage then was the Libyan government forces. I think this was in the 80s. She took the line of voice for the conflict. And I think she was sidelined later on within the BBC. But she decided, no, I'm going to show what it is, a certain part of the conflict. But conflict reporting, I believe, is not as easy as reporting the release of a movie. It is not. It's a different ballgame, it's a different science. And I really think our country needs a policy on conflict reporting. I really think that all our TV channels need to subscribe to a model code of conduct in conflict reporting. Because if I tell you that a news report at times has meant dead bodies in the evening, I would not be lying. I would tell you a reality, a truth, that at least 5 to 6% in the last 30 years, maybe 5 to 6% dead bodies that we've seen, targeted killings, have resulted from news, false or true, in newspapers, in news channels, the local newspapers, or the national channels, the way they report things. And the biggest problem I was here when this was arranged for me, some things we spoke was so true. When we go on TV channel, for example, we are all at that interview. We find out that the person who is interviewing us has absolutely no knowledge about the subject. And they ask questions, and we don't know what to answer, because the question is simply, it actually doesn't make any sense. It's very important that if you send a reporter in a conflict zone, the ethics of conflict, the ethics of media reporting, be embedded in the psyche of that reporter. Otherwise, if you ask me, at least in our country, in the state of J&K, I will say unambiguously that media has now, in our country, trespassed into reality where they have become a part of the problem. We don't want them to be a part of the solution. But certainly they could resist and not become a part of the problem. I remember in 2004, I was somewhere. And they said, how many parties are there in Kashmir? Kishan. He said, three. Somebody said three. There was somebody from Bhujan. He said, India, Pakistan, and the people of J&K. I said, no, there are four. India, Pakistan, J&K, and the media. Media community. Hello, what are you coming from? So he says, the point is that they've actually started their own opinion. They've now sacrificed. Now take one more point. Be very honest. Hum jab Kashmiri ka dekhte hain, ya Kashmir Musliman ka dekhte hain, there is an identification. Because you see a village who is going himself out. You see Milton Gudam, they happen to be Kashmiri, and they happen to be Muslim also. Which is shown on the media, which is good. But has anybody in the Indian media ever focused on the fact the number of Kashmiri Muslims who have laid down their lives in line of duty for their country, for India? The number of Kashmiri Muslims who have died fighting for their country is not less than 50,000. That is not to our Jammu Kashmir police ka sipahi hai, wo shaheed hai. The political leaders and the political workers, the number is around 20 to 25,000 who have been killed for their, because they have committed the crime of fighting elections or electioneering. Uske liye maar. Then there were people who were non-state actors but believed in the cause of India and were facilitating the army and other security forces. 20,000 to wo mara gaya. So 50-55,000 log. Aap mujhe bata dein ki pure mulk mein which single community has sacrificed more? 50,000 people, Kashmiris, of a particular Kashmiri Kiteke, and who have sacrificed their lives. But today, when there is anger, because some idiots, some despicable people out there, 100 or 200 or 500, videograph celebrations of the barbaric act that took place, put it on Facebook, which is having a bad impact, maybe in Jammu, and in many other places, like I was there, 30-40 organizations from students. Because we've been branded and generalized as one commodity, as on this as the reality lies elsewhere. Need to fight being the battle, the war being fought in JNK for India is being fought mainly to a great extent by Kashmiris. Nobody talks about it. He's the unsung hero. Even if you know, the government takes care of the families. When a jawan in duty, whether it's a policeman, a CRP personnel, or an army, when they die in action, when they are martyred in action, the government takes care of them. There are monuments, there are other things. Our state, we are very poor state. Our jawan lucky gets it. Compared to the other. The other part of security force. So I will just say and conclude and say that conflict reporting is a science. Don't treat it as like reporting a movie or reporting a new restaurant. It's much beyond that. It's about lives, and it's better to have no PRPs rather than